Good evening, everybody. Today we are going to start with, continue with classical criticism, and we are going to focus on Aristotle. Last time the focus was on Plato, and today it's going to be on Aristotle. So let's begin. See, there's this word classical. There are three words basically that you usually hear, that is classic, classical, classicism. So what is classic? Classic is, any work, any major work like that of Shakespeare and Austen that has got high standards and that has stood the test of time. And classical is anything that's relating to Greek and Roman times, any text which belongs to that era. And you have major critics of this age, classical age, that's Plato, Aristotle, Longinus, and Horace. And classicism, there's another word called classicism. What's classicism? Classicism is qualities that are characteristic of the best literature of Greece and Rome. So in classicism, you identify it with idealism, intellectual inequality, emotions are involved in that. Then there is restraint, no excess of anything, very specific. And the structure is also very specific and contained. Classical criticism and romanticism, what's the difference between that, between classical criticism and romanticism? Classical criticism is an attempt at expressing infinite ideas and feelings in a finite form. So the classical critics, they laid down certain principles. They focused on formal style and qualities like clarity, orderliness, balance, and they also determined which work is fit for being canonized and which should be in the libraries. And these scholars, they began to call themselves critics or judges. So classical criticism was dominant till the 18th century. And after the 18th century, from then onwards, then you have the romantic criticism. So romanticism, they rejected classical criticism. It was a response to classical criticism. And why was it rejected? Because classical criticism was too rationalistic and too formal. And romanticism is an attempt to express a kind of universal poetry in the creation of which the poet made his own law. So here the poet is given a lot of freedom. And the individual or the subject is more important here. What else can we say about classical criticism and romanticism? So another thing that comes to mind is in classical criticism, like if I'm talking about differences between the two of them, in classical criticism, unity of time, place, and action is present, whereas in romanticism, there's only the unity of action. In classical criticism, is strict, rigid, and logical diction, whereas in romanticism, the diction is very simple. They're using the language of the common man. The classical critics, they believed in customs and tradition, and in the case of romanticism, the poets were given the freedom to express themselves and choose whatever they wanted to, and they tried to make the ordinary look beautiful in where romantic critics were concerned. Now let's go to Aristotle. He was a student of Plato, but he was also the strongest critique of Plato, and he's known for his treatise, the Poetics. His life was intimately connected to the politics of the Greek world, and he later became the tutor of Philip's son, Alexander the Great. You must have all heard of Alexander the Great. Alexander the Great was a student of Aristotle. Aristotle moved to Athens when he was 17 years and he became a student of Plato. He lived there in Athens till the year of Plato's death. Though he was Plato's pupil, his ideas and thoughts varied from his master. He agreed that, just like Plato, he agreed that poetry was mimesis, but that is imitation, but he stopped short of condemning poetry. Like Plato was condemning the poets and poetry, but Aristotle didn't do that. Plato had very specific views of art, and Aristotle took over a few principles of art in his Poetics, and he raised some serious and systematic critique of Plato indirectly. He didn't directly critique Plato. It was all done in a very indirect manner. Plato believed poetry to be cut off from the universal and hence was far from the truth. That is, poetry is not truth. Aristotle, on the other hand, thought otherwise. Aristotle's Poetics contains four major parts, which we will be covering: the concept of mimesis, genre classification, six elements of tragedy, and catharsis. Mimesis is imitation, and genres of poetry will be epic, tragedy, comedy, and the six elements of tragedy, which we'll be doing in this today's session. Catharsis also will be covered today. So how did Aristotle defend art? Plato had, when we look at Plato, he made very sweeping generalizations on the nature and function of art. But Aristotle tried to defend art against Plato. He said, art cannot be a lie. It's an imitation of an object. In such a representation, the artist never claims it to be real, and art should be placed on a different pedestal. In order to find the nature and function of art, we have to take a particular form of art and place it under investigation. So what he is trying to say is that, you know, you can't with a single brush, you can't just paint everything and say that this is unreal, because there are different forms of art and each form has got its own structure and own form. So you have to, if you want to critique a particular form of art, you have to investigate that particular form and come to a conclusion. You can't just straight away say that this is not real, that is not real. You can't do that. You will have to place each and every form under investigation and then come to a decision. While Plato condemns art because he says it's a copy of a copy, because reality is imitation of the form. For Plato, the highest level is the form. The form is the transcendental thing, you know. And art is, according to him, art is an imitation of reality. Whereas Aristotle defends art by saying that in the appreciation of art, the viewer receives a certain cognitive value from the experience. But Plato fails to explain that art also gives something more, which is absent in the actual. The artist does not simply reflect the real in the manner of a mirror. Art cannot be slavish imitation of reality. Literature is not the exact reproduction of life in all its totality. It is a representation of selected events and characters necessary in a coherent action for the realization of the artist's purpose. Now, what are the various ideas that Aristotle had put forth. You know, he had a lot of theories. So one of the theories that Aristotle had put forth is that they are related to biological organisms, the art. His theories are all related to biological organisms. Just as each species of plant has its own distinctive principles of growth and fulfillment, so does each genre of art evolve in itself. So just like I said before, Aristotle does not judge all the works by employing the same standards. For each genre, he has got his a particular standard, and he doesn't give individual qualities to individual works. He avoids doing that. But even all these things said and done, he still considers tragedy to be superior to the epics and the like. But both tragedy and epic should have unity of action. Aristotle, you know, he believed that art imitates nature. He believed that the world is dominated by, like I told you earlier, these biological organisms. So he believes that all incidents must be so arranged in such a way that if any of them is differently placed or taken away, the effect will be seriously disturbed. So see, in this case, he says that tragedy and epic should have unity of action. So what does he mean by that? He says that in tragedy, which we'll be covering obviously later, all the actions which are there in tragedy should follow one after the other in sequence. And if one part in that sequence goes awry, or it is misplaced, or it's put in another position, then the whole thing falls flat. Then that it doesn't become a success. So here, tragedy and epic should have unity of action. Only that will make it a success. He also emphasizes that whatever art you put out should take into account the capacity and limitations of the spectator. So, you know, whatever you are showing, the drama or anything that you are going to show to the viewers, you should know who the people are who is receiving this, who are watching this. You should know the capacity. Are they able to understand? Will they be able to respond to this? So you should know the capacity and the limitation of the spectators. So basically, you have to focus on the unity of time, place, and action. All these three things are important in where Aristotle is concerned. When he's talking about art. Another idea that Aristotle had put forth is about probable impossibilities. It's there in your study material. It will be there in block 2. So he says probable impossibilities are to be preferred to improbable possibilities. A convincing impossibility is preferable to a non-convincing possibility. So now when we read this, it gets a bit confusing. So I'll just put it in an easy to understand way. Probable impossibility means it's a situation that is impossible to happen in the real world. You know, a situation that cannot happen in the real world, impossible to happen in the real world. But it is probable it can happen in the universe of imaginary events. So if you imagine, you can, it is possible. That particular impossible event can happen in your imaginary world, though it is not possible in reality. Okay, so you can create your own imaginary events, but you have to create believable plots. Like, for example, I think there was these animation movies you have, you know, Finding Nemo and all that. You don't have fishes talking and everything in real life. That is impossible. But in the imaginary world, you can imagine the fish talking and, you know, Nemo gets lost and, you know, people are looking out, the other fishes are looking out for him. So the plot seems to be a possibility. So the possibility should be believable, like it's happening, you know, these things can take place, this looking for the, those actions are possible. So this is what he says about probable impossibilities. Okay. And what is improbable possibility? Improbable possibility is a situation that is possible in the real world, but it is extremely unlikely to happen. It's a thing that will never take place. So it is possible, but it will very unlikely that it's going to take place. So Plato says that he would prefer that the probable impossibility over the improbable possibility. Then what was Plato's idea of truth? So he says, a poet does not impersonate or copy or misrepresent reality. What is his idea on poetry? Sorry. So he tries to create a distinction between poetry and history. So he says, a poet will not impersonate or copy or misrepresent reality. Reality is being presented in a different way. So it looks as if it's a copy, but it is not. It is being presented in some other way. So what is the difference between truth in history and truth in poetry? Now, where history is concerned, it's consisting of actual facts written in a very chronological manner and narrating a story, and it represents an action. Whereas poetry, it is concerned about the general truth of what may be. And it points to the universal and permanent possibilities of human nature. It's of a higher order. Poetry is of a higher order. History will describe how things were, whereas poetry is based on moral views as to how things should be. So here, the poet has got the freedom, and he has got more power over how to influence the public by writing. You know, he can write something where he can influence the people who are reading it. So poetic truth is superior to historic truth. So, you know, Plato used to say that poetry is false, trivial, harmful, whereas Aristotle used to say that poetry is true, and it is not trivial, it is serious, and it is helpful. Plato's views on mimesis. So you might get a question on this. What was Plato's and Aristotle's view on mimesis? Plato's view on mimesis was already covered to you. So I'm just going to just straight give you a very short intro to this. Plato, he was very disparaging towards the art form. And he says, mimesis is a representation of nature that was inherently inferior to the original. Impersonation can inculcate bad or non-rational habits, and it focuses attention on mere phenomena. Plato was worried that people observing villains or despicable characters in poetry would imitate them. You know, he used to think that, whereas Aristotle believed that bad examples will teach people how not to behave, just as good examples teach people how to behave. So this was Plato's view on mimesis. And Aristotle's view was, he tried to salvage the reputation of mimetic art. He says that it is a natural human impulse to make art that imitates the people, places, and events around them. Mimesis involved not just imitation, but addition of symbolism and structure, and lets their audience draw meaning from the work. So earliest lessons, he says, are learned through, that's what Aristotle says, the earliest lessons you learn through imitation, through mimesis. And reason why men enjoy seeing a likeness, why is it that men enjoy seeing something that is mimed, that is mimesis, why is it? because in contemplating they find themselves learning or inferring. Like for example, if you see something, an object outside which is not very attractive, a real life object, it might not seem attractive to you at all. But let somebody create that same thing, reproduce that as a sculpture or as a poem or as a drawing or a painting. And when you look at it, you say, oh, it's so beautiful, it's wonderful. Why are you saying that? Because you are comparing that artwork to the real, and you are just trying to see, and you're saying, see how exactly, how similar it is, the both, how true to life it has been created, you know, so that way you're appreciating it, and it's drawing appreciation. So that is why he says it is learning. You're learning in that way. It's creating pleasure, and because you're contemplating over it. So an object may not be appreciated, but a painting of it will draw appreciation. According to Plato, all creation was imitation of the forms, which is transcendental. For Aristotle, the form of every object existed. It was not a transcendental reality, but something within nature. And he said that art helps nature to attain perfection of the form. Aristotle's theory of mimesis in tragedy. Now, today we'll be covering more on tragedy. So let us go through this mimesis word, mimesis again. Mimesis is a Greek word. It means imitation, and it is a representation rather than copying. So that means you are taking some form from that reality, you're drawing it or you're creating it, and you're putting in your own ideas also in it, your symbols and your imagination also, you are adding on to it. So he stressed that in tragedy, mimesis meant the imitation of an action. And what action? Tragedy means of a man falling from a higher state to a lower state. And generally, you know, when even though he talked about mimesis in tragedy, it's not just applicable only to tragedy, it is applicable also to comedy and to epics also. But he focused more on tragedy because he placed tragedy at a higher level. So what about mimesis? Mimesis is a very distinctive aspect of human nature, you know, imitation. There's an instinct to imitate. Ever since when a child is baby is born, it imitates its parents, you know, whatever facial expressions are shown by the parents, the baby also imitates. So he's a man, a woman is the most imitative of all creatures. So the pleasure that mimesis provides is on account of the knowledge that is acquired through mimesis. So in effect, what Aristotle is trying to say is that an artist is not a liar, but someone who leads us to the truth. So major elements in Aristotle's definition of tragedy. Now, see, there are six elements in tragedy. This is not to do with the six elements of tragedy. This is about the elements in the definition of tragedy. What is tragedy? Tragedy is an imitation or representation of an action with requisite seriousness. It should have a definite form and magnitude. It should be presented in a proper manner that arouses pity or fear to yield pleasure or evoke admiration from the readers or spectators. So this is a short, a very concise definition of tragedy. Imitation or representation of an action. So it's a serious action, you know, there is some seriousness involved in that particular action. There's nothing comic about it. And it should have a definite form and magnitude. Form and magnitude. Magnitude means size. A series of incidents. And what does it contain? This magnitude inside, what does it contain? It contains a series of incidents. They are connected in a logical manner and it is presented artistically. So like when you see a watch a drama, you know the incidents that are there and you are put, imagine those incidents to be blocks. You connect those blocks series in a logical manner, like, you know, episode 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. You don't put 1, 3 and 5 and then you put 2 later on, 2 and 4 later. You will put it in the logical sequential manner in which it's supposed to take place. And it is presented also in a very artistic manner so that, you know, everybody is able to appreciate it. And it should be such that, you know, it's not like, you know, people watch something and they say, okay, it's over, finished. They have to have some feelings. It should arouse certain feelings. And what is the feeling where tragedy is concerned? It should arouse pity and fear to yield pleasure. Pleasure in the sense means not happy feeling. It means a feeling of, it's like a kind of a satisfaction that you, you know, at the end, when the whole thing is over, you should have a satisfaction that, you know, okay, this has taken place and, you know, it's a catharsis is taking place. That is what is meant over here. And evoke admiration from the readers and spectators. You know, people should be able to appreciate it. Besides this, we have two words, you know, mimesis and digesis. This I'm just giving it as an extra thing. What is mimesis? Mimesis, you know, it shows rather than explain the action. Mimesis is you're miming everything. The character is, you know, showing the action, displaying the action and using a voice which is not their real voice, is imitating a character. So this will be like tragedy and comedy has got mimesis. And what is digesis? Digesis is like a narration. You know, when a poet is speaking in his or her own voice, it will be called digesis. So example, dithyramb, which is a kind of hymn, that uses digesis. Epic, you must have heard of epic. In epic, you have both mimesis and digesis. So, you know, that you'll have somebody narrating something and then an action taking place. You're watching that action taking place. So in epics, you have both a mixture of mimesis and digesis. So with that, we come to the end of one part of Aristotle. I hope you're